So it's taken a long time, but it was great to see Jenny Leong, who was a member of Parliament, State Parliament for the Greens in New South Wales in Australia, speaking out against the anti-China warmongering that's happening and has been happening now for quite some time. Since it's been gradually building since the pivot to Asia by President Obama in 2014. And of course, is getting really to a sort of ridiculous level here in Australia. And when I saw this video, which it's a speech that she gives in Parliament about the anti-China, the anti-Asian hate crimes in Australia and throughout the world, and also that we are basically being dictated to, our foreign policy is being dictated to by the U.S., and how that has dragged us into many, many wars. She hits a lot of different points that are really, really important that Australian politicians do not do. And it was quite a shock to see this particular politician, even though she's a state politician, a parliamentarian. It was very, very important to see this being spoken out loud, because I'm sure there are a lot of parliamentarians in Australia, a lot of politicians that are aware of this issue, that we are basically following along with US foreign policy into endless wars that are causing chaos and destruction all throughout the world, but they're not saying anything. And that is actually, that silence is a complicity in those wars. And also they're not really voting against, they just go along with it. In fact, the Labor Party has recognized Juan Guaido of Venezuela, a self-appointed politician that is completely supported by the U.S. empire and is basically trying to sell out Venezuela and, you know, have the U.S. that he openly asked the U.S. to invade Venezuela. I mean, these are the kind of traitors that we are recognizing, and they're trying to basically destroy their own countries because they don't care. They want to line their pockets. They want power. Anyway, so what's happening in Australia is a lot of rabid anti-China propaganda from the Murdoch Press, which owns 75% of all media here in Australia. And we have politicians that either aren't saying anything or are putting out anti-China sentiment, like a lot of the right-wing parties are doing that. The Labor Party is barely saying anything whatsoever, which is I see as complicity, or being fearful of criticizing U.S. foreign policy, you know, which is par for the course. And so this one politician is just a sort of like a little shining beacon of truth when she talks about this. I wish that more of Greens would speak out about this, but unfortunately they don't. They certainly, the Greens here in Tasmania, do not. In fact, they tend to amplify like anti-Assange type smearing, like Cassie O'Connor for the Tasmanian Greens. She tends to be completely clueless about a lot of U.S. imperialist stuff, or if she's not clueless, she certainly doesn't say. When she does speak, it's usually something that is U.S. national security state talking point. So anyway, this particular Newtown member, a member for Newtown, who's a Green, Jenny Leong, I rang her up. The receptionist answered the phone, and we had a really good chat, and I congratulated Jenny Leong on being courageous and actually mentioning the word U.S. and talking about the wars, the other wars, not just because she happens to be Asian and she's speaking out about this anti-China warmongering, but, you know, she mentioned these other wars that we're being dragged into here in Australia. And I said, that's a very brave thing to do, because you know what happened with Gough Whitlam, and he was, you know, helped, the CIA admitted to help ousting him, you know. So politicians are very afraid of the US. They're more concerned about their career, and so they won't say anything. It's just a complete no-go zone. It's verboten to have that sort of discussion or debate even, no matter what. It doesn't matter if it's the ABC, who's now kind of sold out and pushing anti-China propaganda. There's also Four Corners, who's sold out and is pushing anti-China propaganda. All kinds of different media here have all sold out. They sold out a long time ago, and they're all pushing nonsense. So, you know, we have no real fourth estate to speak of, except for maybe Caitlin Johnson, who is pushing, is an anti-imperialist journalist. And I don't really count, because I'm not a journalist, and I'm a tiny little channel. But I do my best to push against the imperialist narratives that we have here. And I'm sure there probably are some small you know, sort of journalists, you know, sort of independent journalists somewhere, but their voices are not, I don't really hear from them. So, you know, it's a very worrying thing. And I also mentioned to Jenny Leong's receptionist that you know, the Gaza Fights for Freedom documentary, because I think she is also pro-Palestinian. You have to be, really, if you're anti-imperialist, you have to be pro-Palestinian because it's so tied together. But the Israel lobby is very strong in Australia, just as it is here, just as it is in the United States. And so not many people will speak out. The Labour Party does this kind of mealy-mouth stuff. Everybody's pretty mealy-mouthed, particularly when it comes to BDS. So I suggested anyway to Jenny Leong, I haven't really looked into any of her speeches, if she's done any about Israel and the apartheid situation. Well, it's worse than apartheid there. But I think she is pro-Palestinian. She wants the end to the apartheid state there. And the oppressiveness and the genocidal stuff there. So I suggested that documentary of Avi Martin from the Empire Files, and suggested they should have like a film night. And she thought that the receptionist thought that was a really good idea. And that would be great, because the more people that see that, particularly in Australia, the better, because they can kind of link then U.S. imperialism and this ethno-supremacist nuclear-powered regime that is Israel oppressing and committing a genocide ongoing since the Nakba in 1948. So it's really important that people put that together, that U.S. imperialism is inextricably linked to the oppression of Palestinians and the ethnic cleansing, the genocide, basically, of Palestinians, and that the U.S. Empire gives Israel $3.8 billion, with a B, every year to continue on, of military aid to continue on that genocide, and also so that they can also do proxy wars against countries that are the targets of the US, like Syria and Lebanon and so forth. I mean, what isn't a target, basically? Any country that is not doing the bidding of the US is a target in some way. So anyway, that was so good. That was really warmed my heart to see that speech of hers today. I just happened to accidentally see it on Twitter, and I just thought, wow, I wish more politicians would speak like that and use the broader sense, not just about the warmongering against China, which could lead to an actual war on China, but the warmongering in general that's going on, the meddling, the constant meddling that the US is doing. 50-plus countries since World War II have been meddled with and overthrown. Their governments and whatever have been overthrown since World War II, and that is something... You know, the people in Australia need to understand and realize this is so, not only is it appalling human rights abuses that the US is engaging in and getting us to go along with them, but it is also, it is a multipolar world now. China and Russia are making allies with other countries. It is a multipolar world which the US cannot bear to see, that they want full spectrum dominance by any means necessary. And the Australians need to realize that and stop thinking that the US is the good guy. I mean, seriously, there are a lot of people who still think that. I don't know who, why people would think that, but they do.
It's been over a year since the most recent anti-Chinese rhetoric started with COVID, but this was certainly not the beginning. 1901 saw the White Australia policy enacted, in part a response to the resentment by white miners held by the success of Chinese miners on the goldfields, further entrenching systemic racism on top of colonial invasion and genocide inflicted on First Nations people. Jump forward to the rise of One Nation and Pauline Hanson warning of fears of Asian invasion, and John Howard's tough on border claim that we decide who comes to this country. Oh, how proud they both must be today of Morrison and Dutton's skillful implementation of racist border policies under the guise of a global pandemic, which initially saw those from China being sent to Christmas Island, and now our borders shut to those wishing to return home from India. We must focus locally and globally on rebuilding our commitment to international solidarity and re-strengthening our efforts towards an activist-led peace movement. Many of us have continued to suffer through an increase in anti-Asian racism and distrust, and there are real consequences for this. A member of the New South Wales Parliament had their house raided by ASIO. New South Wales councillors with Chinese heritage have received letters and death threats. Reports documenting discrimination in the media, barriers for people working in the public service, increases in racist attacks, citizens having their loyalties questioned at Senate committees, universities being subjected to foreign interference laws, the Human Rights Commission being criticised for their racism It Stops With Me campaign, and then there's the endless tirade of racist crap and so-called jokes hurled at public figures. This is not okay. The message from many at the Stop Asian Hate vigil that I joined recently outside Customs House in Sydney was clear. We will no longer be silent. We will no longer be your model migrants. You will not stereotype us as geeks. You will not objectify us as the subject of your exotic fantasies. And we will not shy away from speaking proudly about our cultural heritage for fear that you will brand us as apologists for the Chinese Communist Party. On top of this racism, but absolutely connected to it, we are seeing the emergence of an alarmist warmongering narrative, in some cases being driven by those who will directly profit from shifts to a war footing. The Greens are proudly a party that have at its core a respect for principles of peace and non-violence. We abhor the militaristic pronouncements by the likes of the Home Affairs Secretary with his appalling drums of war rhetoric, or the not-so-confidential briefing to Australia's Special Forces soldiers last year. This Cold War rhetoric and the anti-China posturing is dangerous. It serves political aims and fans racism at the expense of well-considered diplomacy in this country and around the globe. We on the left have an important role to play in cutting through the propaganda and the anti-Chinese sentiment. We need to be pushing for an independent foreign policy that enables us to advocate for a realistic approach to China-Australia relations. And we must remind people that while Australia has long hitched a ride on the US's coattails when it comes to foreign policy, that means we have shamefully followed the US into every single war for decades. We must be at our core anti-racist in our approach to all that we do. And that includes how we talk about and what we do when it comes to international relations and to China. It's not easy, and there are many complexities to negotiate. But if we vacate this space, if we leave it to be open and be filled by hawks and those posing as doves who claim to care about human rights, but when you scratch the surface below, find a disturbing mix of white savior complexes and entrenched fear of yellow peril, then we will have lost. Let us be inspired by the peace activists and the anti-racism campaigners here and around the globe, past and present. Let us remember the actions of those that have inspired us and continue to take a strong commitment to international solidarity, to peace, to non-violence in our local communities and around the globe.
And the last little video, there's two videos I want to play after this. They're only short ones after this speech by Jenny Leong, the member for Newtown, the state Greens member in New South Wales. After that, I want to show you the humans of the CIA. That's the CIA's propaganda side about themselves, trying to pretend like they're real lefties and progressives and all of that, and that they care about other ethnic groups and races and all of that sort of thing, intersectional and all of that. And big women's supporters. This is what the CIA is trying to put out. They're trying to get some more recruits to their awful imperialist, it's the invisible army of capitalism. That's what the CIA is. So they're trying to get recruits, and they know that there are a lot of young people now are awake up to these different issues due to, you know, sort of the internet. And so they have to find a way of getting in and making them think that they're in some way supportive of LGBT people and trans people and, different groups and women and whatever, minorities. They're trying to sort of make themselves awoke, and that's what they're doing. And so this is another one of their videos of many from the humans of the CIA. I call them the useful idiots of the CIA because this guy, he's probably an actor pretending to be the CIA agent. They don't show his face, but I'd be pretty sure he's Asian. He may even be Chinese. I don't think that's probably his voice either. He's probably engaged in secret ops, you know, to basically help with this intentional war on China. So anyway, he's talking about, you know, how his parents were, you know, moved to the US and they've been there for decades, and he thought it was a really good idea to join the CIA. He said he didn't come from a war-torn country, which makes me think it's probably China. And, you know, he's going to... And basically, I had to have a black sort of a view on it and sort of go, yes, well, you know, you it's not war-torn, but you're going to make sure it is. And so, you know, that's really sad. I mean, I see these people as kind of traitors to their own country and traitors to humanity, basically, to participate in trying to drum up a war on countries, you know, that are just trying to sort of, they're just trying to be, they're not trying to have full spectrum dominance like the US. They're not trying to destroy other countries. they're just trying to be. And so I'm going to play you that little humans from the CIA with this particular, I think, is a Chinese operative who they won't show his face, and it's probably not even his voice. And then after that, I'm going to show you a very short clip of Putin, President Putin from Russia, who is talking about how the U.S. is spreading itself very thin, how Russia is trying to move away and make itself sanction-proof, move away from the U.S. dollar, and how there are other countries doing the same, so that, you know, they can become at some point sanction-proof in a way, because Iran is under crippling sanctions, or has been. I'm not sure what's happening right now. Venezuela is still, the Biden administration is still, just like the Trump administration, it's just a seamless thread, doing all the awful things the Trump administration did. It's just this unelected government continuing on, and that Venezuela is still under these awful sanctions that have killed 40,000 plus Venezuelans since 2017. So, Russia, the Russian President Putin is basically saying that, the U.S. is spreading itself thin. It cannot accept that there's a multipolar world, and countries are now trying to extract themselves and make themselves sanction-proof, by moving away from the U.S. dollar. So that is something that I see. Anything that moves to a multipolar world that isolates the U.S. and makes empire fall, anything that does that, I'm totally on board with that, because it is reaching dangerous levels now, where any empire that is falling becomes very dangerous, and that's why they're wanting to have a war on China, because they see China as a great economic threat, which it is, of course. This is capitalism. They only like capitalism when they are the ones that are dominating and sanctioning and crushing with all the world, World Bank and all of that. They're only okay when they're the ones that are on top, with their foot on the necks of all these other countries. But when another country who was basically like China, who was surpassing them in economically, that's when it's absolutely unacceptable, and that's when it becomes a danger for that country, and that's why there is so much warmongering against China. We also, by the way, talked with Jenny Leong's receptionist about the Australian Strategic Policy Institute, which is putting out propaganda all the time about China, and it's all funded by, and I've talked about Australian Strategic Policy Unit, Policy Institute on this channel a few times now. It's very dangerous. It's funded by the weapons industry. You see Raytheon and all kinds of different, brand names of different weapons manufacturers. It's just a propaganda branch of the U.S. national security state. And unfortunately, it informs Parliament, and it sends out uninvited sort of propaganda even to the Greens. They don't want that sort of propaganda, but that's what they do. So anyway, it was great to see Jenny Leong give that speech. I hope it really catches on, like the 100th monkey theory, that more and more people feel courageous enough, and also put together that the oppression of Palestinians is also linked to the U.S. empire, and that we must be anti-imperialists if we are pro-Palestinian. We should take heart that I think there is this change that is happening, and I think people are realizing things about. There are people, of course, that are completely drawn into this propaganda, but there are people who are waking up, and it only takes a certain part of the population of the world, particularly in the West. It only takes a small percentage for it to start to really, like algae on a pond, I use that metaphor, a small amount of algae on a pond, and then before you know it, it's all over the pond. So this is something that we can maybe take heart, that maybe people are trying to wake up, are waking up to what's happening, what the U.S. is doing around the world. We can only hope. And that's Nani in the background with the Palestinian flag. Every time I unfurl that flag, some little guy has to come and sit on it. Anyway, so thanks for watching. Check out these next three videos. They're not very long. Thanks for watching. My name is Trish Roberts. You're watching Faint Signals from Vega. Till next time. Bye for now.
When my parents immigrated to the U.S. decades ago, they came for personal and economic opportunity. Where they came from wasn't a conflict zone or land ravaged by disaster and poverty. They couldn't have foreseen that now, decades later, that place would see its freedoms dramatically undermined, and some of its young and middle-aged people emigrating to free countries to create new lives for themselves and their families. Because of the decisions they made and their sacrifices, I am an American. Early on in school, I was interested in international relations. And even then, I believed firmly in the need for dedicated American public servants to protect our national security and defend our democratic system. CIA welcomes applications from U.S. citizens from all backgrounds. So why wouldn't I apply? My work at CIA is nothing what I expected as an applicant, but it's been so much more exciting and worthwhile than I thought it would be. I've traveled to many places around the globe, including a few destinations I never thought I would. I joined with some foreign language skills, and then at CIA I got the time and training to build on them, so now I can speak these languages at a professional level. Over the years, I've encountered people who took pause because I didn't look like what they expected of a CIA officer. Many also didn't know I was second-generation American. It's taught me to more fully appreciate the great promise of America. I am the son of immigrants. I work for CIA, the premier intelligence service of the world. I've seen the organization make a lot of progress towards living out our American values. My colleagues, fellow members of the CIA family, have embraced my husband and me. We all know CIA has a critical and challenging mission, and we all understand the need to take care of the officers dedicating themselves to our mission and the families who sacrifice and support them. No matter what, we are all Americans. We are all CIA officers, and we all serve the same mission.
Понимаете, у нас проблемы. Ну что нам делать? Мы переходим на расчеты в национальных валютах, переходим на расчеты в других валютах других стран. Они нас вынуждают это делать, наши американские партнеры. Мы не уходим сознательно, а мы вынуждены это делать. Но когда мы это делаем, складывается определенная система наших финансовых отношений с партнерами. Уже вне долларовой зоны. Ну зачем это делают политические власти в Соединенных Штатах? Они подпиливают сук, на котором сидят. В конце концов, грохнется. Все же видят это в мире. Понимаете, в чем дело? Все видят. И возникает вопрос надежности долларовых расчетов. Поэтому сокращаются золотовалютные резервы в долларах. Не только у нас. Практически во всем мире. В том числе и у союзников США. Сокращается объем расчетов в долларах. Я сейчас просто боюсь ошибиться в цифрах, но вы посмотрите статистику мировых международных институтов. Посмотрите, там же это не наша статистика. Это статистика международных финансовых институтов. И вы видите, что из года в год объемы расчетов в долларах сокращаются. И золотовалютные резервы в долларах тоже сокращаются. Не только у нас. Ну, с нами тем более, это все больше и больше санкций. Мы слышим угрозы продолжающиеся там откуда-то из Конгресса, еще откуда-то. Все это делается в ходе внутриполитических каких-то процессов в США. Но те люди, которые это делают, они исходят, видимо, из того, что... Мощь экономическая Соединенных Штатов, военная мощь, политическая такова, что это не страшно. Что это... Ну, мы переживем, они думают. Вы знаете, в чем проблема? Я вам это скажу, как бывший гражданин бывшего Советского Союза. В чем проблема империи? Им кажется, что они такие могущественные, что они могут позволить себе небольшие погрешности и ошибки. Ничего, этих купим, этих напугаем, с этими договоримся, этим дадим бусы, этим погрозим военными кораблями. И мы решим проблему. Но количество проблем нарастает. И наступает момент, когда с ними уже не справятся. И Соединенные Штаты уверенной поступью, уверенной походкой, твердым шагом идут прямо по пути Советского Союза. Но, я повторяю еще раз, это не наша инициатива. Некоторые наши компании, например, в нефтяном секторе, они, имея в виду волатильность национальных валют, они не хотят уходить от доллара сегодня. Но если их будут вынуждать это делать, в конце концов, и они найдут способ додолларизации своих расчетов. И в национальных валютах, и в валютах третьих стран. Ну, найдут просто выход, и все. И вот это будет очень серьезным ударом по доллару как мировой резервной валюте. Ну а в целом, да, мировой экономике, конечно, множественность резервных валют и расчетных единиц, конечно, это, в принципе, вещь целесообразная, имея в виду, если мы хотим достичь более устойчивой ситуации в мировых финансах и в мировой экономике в целом.